In 2007, Helen Small published The Long Life, which is an examination of the ways old age has been treated in the Western philosophical tradition from Plato to modern evolutionary ethics. Essentially, the book asks, and asks again, what are the implications of the ineluctable fact that human beings age, grow achy and cranky, and slouch reluctantly but inexorably towards death? And that we know this is happening, and know as well that we are helpless to halt or reverse the process. The book is tough-minded and tender-hearted, and when it won the Truman Capote Award for Literary Criticism in 2008, it helped catapult Helen into new prominence among readers the world over. Now, for those of you who don't know what the Truman Capote Award is, it is one of the most lucrative awards in the profession. We won't ask her how much it is in pounds. I covet that award. Now Helen has published another book. This one is tough-minded too, but there's nothing in it for the tender-hearted, at least insofar as that tender-hearted reader is an uncritical lover of the humanities. For what Helen does in The Value of the Humanities is to carefully examine five of the justifications that have been given for studying and teaching the humanities. Even to recognize that the time is right for such a survey is to acknowledge that many of us who do love the humanities consider the disciplines included in it to be imperiled, in danger of being defunded, or simply so degraded that teachers of the humanities are reduced to mere taskmasters, wardens of a skill set that is rapidly becoming anachronistic. In The Value of the Humanities, Helen does not buckle under the warnings of crisis. She doesn't wring her hands or chastise those who've come up with defenses that haven't worked so far. She doesn't hector or pontificate. She simply explains the history, the power, and the weak spots of the various defenses. And then she says we need them all to make certain that the distinctive purposes served by the humanities survive. As I've said, this is a tough-minded book. It is essential reading for everyone here tonight. And recently, the UK Minister of Higher Education recognized the importance of The Value of the Humanities when he named it the best book of the year. Helen Small is professor of English and university lecturer in English at Pembroke College, Oxford. In addition to the Truman Capote Award, she also won the British Academy Rosemary Crashaw Prize for The Long Life. In 2001, she was awarded the enviable, again, three-year Leverhulme Major Research Fellowship, and she currently holds an AHRC Fellowship, Research Fellowship. She's edited three collections of scholarly essays and seven, count them, seven editions of 19th century literary texts, including works by Dickens, Trollope, Emily Bronte, and George Eliot. She's currently working on two more editions of Vanity Fair and The Way We Live Now. She's been Dean and Deputy Dean of Pembroke, ex officio member of the Domestic Committee. Now, I wonder what that committee does, but never mind. And the Welfare Committee, I wonder what that one does too, of the college. And she raises money for the institution. I don't know how she finds the time. I'm just glad she saved a little for us. It's my very great pleasure to introduce Helen Small.
Thank you, Mary. Thank you all for plowing through the snow to be here. Is this working? Is that okay? Right. I think I'm going to have to sit here because I do have a few PowerPoint slides. They're not essential, but especially when I get to the longer definition of the humanities, I think you might want to be able to put, track your eye over it. Thank you to Catherine for issuing the invitation in the first place, to Mary, to Jane, Chris, and all your administrative staff for making this possible. One of the reasons it's a pleasure to be here is that I had in my mind all the time I was working on this book the degree to which many of you American critics have been, I think, the best influences in the debate. But as I say early on, the experience of writing it was to start to feel actually that our situations are less like than the congruence in the rhetoric we use would suggest. So your project in the main has been the defense of a liberal arts version of the humanities, most simply. When you're in the UK, you're defending something, as you'll know, much more specific to a subject base. So for that and other reasons, I will be interested to know how many of the things that I'm talking about as essential to a good defense of the humanities still ring true in this context, and how many of them are different and might be more useful to you comparatively than as immediately the same. I started writing this book 5 or 6 years ago when the subject assumed new political urgency in the context of the UK's the UK government's decision to up the undergraduate fee from £3,000 to £9,000. That happened pretty much overnight. As you may know, it was accompanied by very extensive student protests and academic protests. It went through notwithstanding, and what was expected to happen for the humanities didn't in fact happen. We thought that it would lead to a rapid reduction in the number of students studying, and that we'd be economically in a very difficult place. In fact, they haven't dropped away, which is good news. And the oddity of our position now is that something we deeply resisted has been rather good for us financially, so we now cross-subsidise other departments of the university. So we're kind of, you know, nobody thinks that the government is going to backtrack on it, but financially we don't quite have the legs to stand on that we wanted to do. So the current main pressure on the humanities is really to do with research funding within universities, what the government thinks it wants to fund, how it accounts for the good of the research that it pays for. I'm not going to say very much about that because I think it is pretty nationally specific, but talking with many of your visiting academics, I think there will be some overlap with what your state legislatures think they're funding and what your philanthropic institutions think they're funding. I want to say one word about the personal context in which this came to be written. I live with a former producer of television inquisitorial journalistic programs, BBC Newsnight and Panorama. And when this debate first came to the fore, he kept giving me a kind of hard time over the dinner table. What is the value of what you do? Go and defend it. You know, tell me why the government should pay for it, which kind of put someone on the spot. I didn't like the pieties that came most easily to my grasp, so I decided I'd better go away and think it through. So really what you're hearing is someone trying to get her own thoughts in order on what those arguments are, where they work and where they cease to work, where we should stop pressing them too hard. But it's also a matter of tone. I've been very interested for a long time in the adopted tone of defences of the humanities, which tend in Britain, and I think to a certain extent in your country, to sound beleaguered and sound special pleading. And I don't think that works for us. I think it is an annoyance and often seen to be a misjudgment before you even start on the part of our politicians. So what they want to hear is something that is more confident, more straightforward, and doesn't pitch it either too high or too low. Right. I'm going to talk you really through the structure of the book and the core arguments. I'm very happy to expand any of the particular areas of justification that might be of particular interest to you, so please just tell me when we come to the question session, but I'll have to do them in fairly tight order. Justifying the humanities' claim to a share of the public budget for research is, I think, a much harder task than defending their claim to support for teaching undergraduates. As one, and he was sympathetic, UK economist put it to me, you have a really hard task in the humanities, and he didn't think it was necessarily possible to do it, explaining why the state should pay for more scholarship about Jane Austen or Shakespeare in an age of austerity. And those are the easy cases, relatively speaking, where you have a clearly custodial relationship to things that many people in the culture already think are important. Stuart Hall observed quite recently that one of the effects of this debate in Britain has been to push us back on a more conservative notion of the canon than we had been working with for some years. I think that's right, and I think it's a problem. So let me talk you through what the main five claims are that I make for the, or that I identify rather, for the value of the humanities. I'm going to start with a working definition of what they do, because it seems to me if you don't have a definition of the work, you have nothing on which value can be based. So let me start with what is it we actually do. The humanities study the meaning-making practices of human culture, past and present, focusing on interpretation and critical evaluation, primarily in terms of the individual response and with an ineliminable element of subjectivity. I've several times regretted the unpronounceability of ineliminable, but otherwise there it stands. A little anodyne, it's somewhat ungainly, but it says something about a distinctive content, cultural practices including but not limited to the arts, and about a distinctive understanding of what is involved in being truthful, so an acceptance that truth claims will not and cannot be founded only on positivistic appeals to evidence, rather that they will necessarily entail the exercise of judgment. That this initial claim says nothing about the further requirements often associated with the humanities, so most obviously historical interpretation, rhetorical analysis, the cultivation of style, creativity, imagination, is because I take these things to be, though vital elements in much of the practice of the humanities, not absolutely generalizable across them.
So one of the biggest difficulties, I think, in the way of defending the humanities at the general level is coming up with a definition that can include the study of, pick your own example, Sufi mysticism, Middle German, the history of plain song, analytic philosophy. We're not defending the same thing, and that makes our job much harder. It is easier, I think, to defend a subject base because you can take an object, take a poem, take a piece of music, and you can demonstrate to people, you can appeal directly to their sense of why that object is interesting. Generalization is harder. Now, any well-trained product of a humanities education in this room is immediately, as I'm speaking, going to be turning a critical eye on the words meaning, culture, individual subjectivity, and probably interpretation and evaluation too. That's what we do, and humanities practitioners will be familiar with the question that typically follows about whether that critical response is in itself sufficiently definitive of what we do. The claim that the special purpose of the humanities is more and less stringently critical thinking tends to find wide approval within the field. The unexamined intellectual life is not worth defending. But a core element in a justification for the humanities, as a core element, it has an obvious question to answer, an objection to answer. It has a questionable assumption of privilege built in over other fields. The critical methods of the historian, the philosopher, the analyst of rhetoric, and so forth are developed to their highest level within their particular disciplines. But critical and philosophical reflection are indispensable to intellectual work everywhere. A biochemist or an economist or a lawyer who just gets on unreflectingly with the current method will be a competent technician, but not someone who can advance understanding of the field. So a common line of argument for those advocates for the humanities who've wanted to retain a distinctive claim to be concerned with critical inquiry is to say that other fields are behaving humanistically as opposed to empirically or positivistically when they respond to a proposition by the impulse to test its assumptions. They are, in short, borrowing qualities more commonly associated with the humanities and especially with philosophy. At this point, the description starts to look a little imperialistic. But in practice, any proactive effort at dominance, over other disciplines is bound to prove self-limiting. As the sociologist Andrew Abbott describes them, such attempts at expansion of the domain give an aggressive discipline its most extensive cross-section. English, for example, claiming control of everything written in texts because English thinks of itself as the master discipline of the interpretation of texts. For each discipline, there is some dimension of definition along which its projection is greater than that of other disciplines. In moments of aggression, it will emphasize this dimension, although doing so may expose it to insufferable competition. Okay, that seems to me right. But if advancing strong claims for a discipline or a grouping of disciplines can be a gesture of imperial advancement that meets with resistance, it can, and with better justification, also be a protective gesture with regard to particular kinds of inquiry and forms of knowledge. Cross-faculty appropriations of the name of the humanities have particular force at present in contexts where certain kinds of work find themselves without a strong defense internal to that field, current conduct of that field. Economic study, for example, that neglects economic history. Cognitive psychology that reserves no skepticism about the explanatory reach of brain imaging. Rational choice modeling that fails to consider the uneven possession of agency. Theorizing about science that forgets to allow for the perspective of the theorist. In all these cases, the term humanistic operates polemically on the front that most clearly distinguishes a neglected edge to those fields from their aggressive edge. One can perceive the marginal prestige of the term humanistic within some areas of the social sciences, and yet know its value in bringing back to notice currently undervalued ways of thinking about the subject, rebalancing the claims of the other disciplines, helping to retain a broader view, and sometimes to restore public conviction. It's in both those kinds of circumstance, then, offensive and defensive, that the qualities by which the humanities claim distinctive purpose become most sharply apparent. Faced with an undervaluation of what they do elsewhere, the humanities will project their most forceful self-image outside the discipline, albeit at the price of temporarily losing sight of other kinds of activity that they foster. Some of what they do is just locally perceptive, or entertaining, or performative, or provocative, and not helped, I think, by being made to sound more important than it is. In such moments, when it is politically important to display the more aggressive edge, we can give a rather fuller description of the humanities. In the main, the humanities value qualitative above quantitative reasoning. They place greater faith in interpretative than in positivistic thinking. Unlike the sciences and the scientific wing of the social sciences, they do not have a dominant methodology. And many of their truth claims are not verifiable as those of the natural sciences are verifiable. They tend accordingly to distrust proceduralism and to value independence of thought. They're oriented as much towards historical analysis as towards synchronic structural analysis, and as much toward the medium of expression as towards its content, tending to see the form-content distinction as itself problematic. They attend to the role of the perceiver in ascertaining even the most philosophically secure of knowledge claims, and they have an interest, often they also take pleasure in the specificity of the object of study and the specificity of the individual response, its content and style, over and above the generalized or collective response. Not least, they respect the products of past human endeavors in culture, even when superseded. These claims relate to trained habits of mind, distinctive intellectual priorities, and tools brought to bear on distinctive kinds of object, distinctive relations to truth claims. They entail some basic assertions of value, what objects we think it's worth studying, concentrating much of our time and attention upon, what modes of studying them we think valid and even important. The greater latent characterological force of the more aggressive defensive claim emerges in and is a product of those moments when there's a competition for priority on matters of common interest across the disciplines. At that point, the humanities will need the stronger self-characterization as one element in the repertoire of advocacy for their own interests. They'll need it whenever other disciplines promote their aggressive edge within the institution, and they'll need it more when that aggressive edge starts to dominate the wider public conversation on matters of public interest, for example, economics. At those moments, distinction of aims and priorities may even legitimately be raised to the order of distinctive virtues. Now, that's as much as I'm going to say on this occasion about the definition of the humanities. There's a great deal more that can be said, and I've said some of it in the book, about how we go on to characterize the differences between what we do in the humanities and the social sciences and sciences. Let me go on to the value claims. So here are four further arguments for the value of the humanities that have been influential historically and that seem to me still to have persuasive power. Each of them can yield more specific claims, which I'm treating here as logically subordinate or attendant. There's a kind of funny thing that happens, I now realize, in some occasions when I speak about this book, which is where hands in the audience come and say, I think I have a sixth category, I think I have a seventh one. And as, yeah, I have to be persuaded these are distinct categories, but maybe NYU will change my mind. Okay. Each of them can yield more specific claims, which I'm treating as logically subordinate or attendant, but which others might want to treat as distinctive and deserving of more notice in their own right. Together, they offer a pluralistic account of value. That's important. One of my assumptions is that a persuasive defense of the value of the humanities has to be plural, and that pluralism at this level does not entail incoherence. There is no one all-silencing justification for the humanities to be had, rather a number of distinct defenses, each arising out of particular ways of thinking about value, purpose, and the nature of the implied opposition. A defense is, after all, a defense against a perceived threat, which may be a defined set of alternative needs and values, economic instrumentalism, for example, or an exclusive empiricism, or a narrowly quantitative estimation of human flourishing. So the first of the value claims. The humanities are useful to society in ways that put pressure on how governments commonly understand use, especially the prioritization of economic usefulness and the standard economic means of accounting for it. Now, I have to use the word government here because I'm working within a UK public funding context, but you can draft in, you know, the alternatives for where your pressures come from, your state legislature, or whatever it is. There is an old line of argument that the humanities are necessarily, some people will say, laudably useless, or to remove from accounts of practical ends and economic utility. That's been a common line of resistance to political economists from Adam Smith onwards, who have stressed usefulness as a desirable aim of a publicly funded education. More recent advocates for the humanities have worked hard to invert the long-standing defense, arguing with good evidence that they make a significant contribution to the knowledge economy and to the economy proper, measurable in terms of the benefits to GDP, footfalls in bookshops, museums, theatres, heritage sites, and so forth. In the UK, we now spend an extraordinary amount of time doing qualitative accounting of these things. Though some who hang on to the old claim defend it absolutely and think the value of the humanities deformed or betrayed as soon as questions of utility or application are brought into consideration, a more plausible interpretation treats usefulness, I think, as a legitimate but only minor or secondary and often accidental aspect of humanities scholarship's public value. I'm particularly interested in the version of this moderate claim that sees the instrumental utility of the humanities as very pertinent to a primary education, pretty pertinent to a secondary education, as we call it, but diminishing in importance as one goes up the scale into higher education, where one is almost by definition dealing with forms of inquiry whose value is more intangible or not yet known. This tapering away of instrumental predictability will be less true for some disciplines, I suppose, obvious cases of medicine, the applied sciences and social sciences and technology. But there will, I think, be a strong measure of truth in the description whenever new and unfettered intellectual inquiry is involved. I'm not going to talk about Arnold in this context, but in the book what I do is to take Arnold as a kind of case study for someone who remembered, I think, not necessarily always for the best reason for the definition of culture, at least not necessarily the most useful contribution now, I think is very, very interesting on that tapering away of instrumentalism as a helpful way of gauging the value of higher education. So I guess what I'm arguing for is a neo-Arnoldianism. That's Isabel Armstrong's gift of a term. Okay, in that context. Now, the third claim, or second of the value claims, if you like. The humanities have a contribution to make to our individual and collective happiness. My extremely annoying and wonderful colleague bounced around the quad of the Oxford College when she saw this on the book jacket and said, "Oh, Helen thinks the humanities make you happy, if only." I nearly break down in relations around there, and she's convinced that is not what the book now says. This may be the least trusted line of defense now, I'm not sure, but it has a distinguished history and it has renewed topicality within governments at the present time. Efforts to understand gains to the public good in ways that go deeper than economic benefits have received serious attention, as you all know, across the disciplines in recent years. And there have been warm encouragements to think about the emotions and passions as themselves goods. What I've tried to do in the book, but I can only sketch out very gesturally here, is to lay out the grounds for a qualitative hedonistic argument for the humanities, testing its weight as a means of rebalancing arguments that stress too exclusively the humanities' critical function. The core assertion here is not the overpitched one that the humanities will make you happy, rather that, as John Stuart Mill set the terms of debate, the humanities can help us understand better what happiness is, how we may better put ourselves in the way of it, and how education may improve the kind and quality of some of our pleasures. For Mill, the impediment in the way of securing the larger claim that they can improve the quality of the society's happiness was the difficulty of persuading individuals who assumed to be interested egoistically in their own happiness why they should care also for the collective or general well-being. That problem still tends to detain politicians. It's less likely to worry utilitarian philosophers for whom the goal just consists in individual psychological improvements. Just add them up. To speak of a happy society is to deal in metaphors, since a society is not a psychological entity in the same way an individual is. On the other hand, I think we know what we mean when we use the phrase a society and a polity whose agreed values and commitments assist the flourishing of the many and not the few. Democracy needs us. This is the most politically ambitious argument now regularly heard for the humanities in Britain, and we got it from you. It's clearly a claim that we would want to have on our side if it can be made secure. It has a proximate source in your liberal arts tradition and prominent recent exponents in Martha Nussbaum, Jeffrey Harpham, and others. Its longer roots, of course, lie in Socrates' claim to be a gadfly, a sort of gadfly given to the polis. I want to give it a slightly hard time because it's an argument that goes almost without critical scrutiny in much advocacy for the humanities. Insofar as we have a modern piety, this is, I think, our modern piety. No one is against democracy. Well, actually, a few people are against democracy. No one should be against democracy. Here are my cautions about it in short form. If the classical model is to work for us, we have to adapt and modernize what was, in its origins, a description of the philosopher as isolated adjutant, not as it now needs to be a description befitting institutionally based professions. That's perhaps the least of our difficulties. We're better practiced than we used to be at articulating the ways in which our professional commitments are or should be underpinned by our democratic commitments. I can see people in this room who've done that job extremely well. More pressingly, it's not automatically clear why this is as strong an argument for a higher education as it is for primary and secondary education. And here we have to factor in the imperfect realization of the democratic goal of access, for a start. So the highest UK aspiration for attendance at universities has been 50%, as far as I'm aware, 46 is the highest we've ever got it. The highest achieved proportion of 18 to 21-year-olds in the US, I think, seems to be just over 50% on your 2009 census figures. Of that total enrollment of students, a diminishing percentage majors in the humanities. Actually, Earl Lewis told me last week that it's pretty flat in your country. Currently just over 15% in the UK. I'm told it's 12%. I actually thought it was slightly higher in the US. we can have a debate over just where we are in the teens, but somewhere in the teens. With the important difference that in your liberal arts curricula, all students have at least some exposure to humanistic studies. So there's the access problem, and we also need to clarify better for ourselves why the democracy needs us claim doesn't commit us to a guardianship model of the democracy, which I think most of us would instinctively resist. So shouldn't we trust the capacities of ordinary, sufficiently educated people? To put it really bluntly, are you really arguing that you need a higher education in the humanities to be a really competent, functioning member of a democracy? That's a problem. Everything comes down in the end to who is included in the us. If the us in democracy needs us is taken to refer to those of us who are scholars or students of the humanities in the universities, it does commit us willingly or not to a guardianship model of democracy. Rational coherence then requires us to accept, however reluctantly, that Plato and Mill were right, and that democracy left to itself is a noble but sluggish beast in need of our goading. But if the us is all members, is a bid for all members of the democracy to protect the good operation of the democracy by exercising our critical capacities, then humanities departments will be one place, an important one, among many nurturing those abilities. The best version of this, I've just flagged up a short quotation from him, is Francis Mulhern. It's only there in podcast form, as far as I'm aware, unless he's done it in the last month. He hasn't published this, but you can listen to him doing a 20-minute paper at Birkbeck in 2010, where he defines the core intellectual practices pursued by the humanities as trained deliberation, criticism, advocacy, evaluation, mediation of ideas with respect to norms of representation, all necessary to the good political functioning of a democracy. He concedes himself that these should be and are qualities of every department of the university. And in the end, the nice phrase he comes up for it is that we are the specialist faculty for training in those things, where they are our primary object and not just part of our general tools, if you like. Democracy needs us is not a definitive claim. It comes into the frame of justifications for the humanities when we give a strong affirmative answer to the question, how political do you want your work to be? That is, it puts the needs of the democracy first and it asks what the humanities can do to serve them. I find Richard Rorty helpful here. I don't always find him helpful, I do in this instance. Does liberal democracy need philosophical justification, he asks, in the priority of democracy to philosophy? Those who view the question pragmatically will say that although it may need philosophical articulation, it does not need philosophical background. On this view, the philosopher of liberal democracy may wish to develop a theory of the human self that comports with the institutions he or she admires, but such a philosopher is not thereby justifying these institutions by reference to more fundamental premises, but the reverse. He or she is putting politics first and tailoring a philosophy to suit. I think there's pretty much the same logic involved with a lot of the criticism that puts the democratic claim to the fore as the strongest claim we can hope to make for ourselves politically. We're putting politics first then and putting the humanities second. What do we do to serve it? The democratic claim rests finally on the status of the humanities then as the specialist agency within the university for a kind of questioning and speculative thinking that should define a general ethos of learning and inquiry in the university. The humanities, centrally concerned as they are with the cultural practices of reflection, argument, criticism, advocacy, evaluation, and speculative testing of ideas, have from that perspective a substantial contribution to make to the good working of democracy. And here again, I think it's worth spelling out that the strength of the current political assertion that the humanities have a larger or more important claim for value here rests on the observation, which I think is correct, but I also think it's historically and politically contingent, that it has become theirs as a consequence of the downgrading of those kinds of thinking in other areas of the university and of public life. The final claim I'm going to look at is that the humanities matter for their own sake. A common feature of all the other justifications I've been treating, the value claims, is that they are consequentialist in some measure. They rest on a conviction that the humanities have good effects in the world by their impact on our cultural life, our happiness, our politics. That consequentialism is likely to be very attractive if you're tasked with demonstrating the humanities' public benefit. But it neglects what has often been thought of as the intrinsic value of the object studied. I'm really interested actually in a UK context in how prominent the term intrinsic value is in policy documents and funders documents that want at some level to make the claim that they're not just pushing us towards instrumentalism, they really believe in the value of what we do. At some point, they early on flag the term intrinsic value, and it's just a flag. One of the reasons that I started to back off from early on was that the Minister of Higher Education, who you kindly referenced as a mixed blessing to be picked out as the Minister of Education's Book of the Year. My email intro has been quite funny at times. One of the things that happened early on was that he came to a function at Oxford for a showcase for research in the humanities, and I ran through an early, I feel like a sort of structural account of the book. He clearly read it on the train or in the car on the way up, stood at the podium and flashed around the term intrinsic value with great enthusiasm, said, "Of course I believe in the intrinsic value of the humanities," and then disappeared back to London. And I thought, right, okay, it's pretty easily picked up. Intrinsic value has long been something of a philosophical embarrassment, considered as a criterion for aesthetic and other modes of judgment. It runs counter to many modern critics' understanding of how pervasively valuations are colored by the perceiver's interests. It's also frequently hampered by being drawn into a mistaken opposition with instrumental value. Sparing you on this occasion the close engagement with recent philosophy of value, I will simply tell you that this isn't, I think, ground that humanities scholars need to be on. We'll do better to argue for the value of the objects and practices that matter to us by calling on long-standing intuitions of value, which are often taken as self-evident by the wider public, and relatedly on the ground of long-standing cultural settlements and evolving agreements about how and why the humanities have value for their own sake. A value that is neither purely intrinsic nor merely subjective. The important point is that if you don't have some version of this claim on the table, you're in trouble, because if you rely solely on the consequentialist or instrumentalist claims, there will usually be something that does the job more directly or better. All of these frames for valuing the humanities need to be at the table, as it were, politically. There are and there will remain deep disagreements about whether the knowledge they pursue is an end in itself, or whether objects should be evaluated in terms of their instrumental use value or desire satisfaction or the contribution higher level study of them can make to the quality of the democratic culture, or indeed just the culture. But pursuing serious and informed reflections on these matters is in itself one of the definitional purposes of the humanities, and the preservation of that cultural good is among the reasons for valuing them. Now, these are the arguments I've wanted to separate out and test. Each of them is legitimate, though not without bounds on its legitimacy. Together, as I've said, they comprise the ground for a pluralistic defense of the value of the humanities. They're all reasons that apply to how we may want to think about the value of studying the humanities at the higher level for ourselves or our children. Casting them into the ring of debate about the public value of the humanities, however, requires something more to be said. Now, I've thought hard about whether I should do this section of the paper for you or not. I'm going to do it. Tough luck. The reason for not doing it would be that I do understand that your funding of the humanities here is not controlled at the state government level in the way that ours is. We are in the UK, at the moment, protected by a Minister of Higher Education who doesn't want to cut the humanities share of the public budget. On the other hand, there seems to me to be a continuity in arguments that generally run something along the value of why should you fund higher education in the humanities when other things can more obviously be given a claim to need that is greater than that of the humanities. So in our context, it's usually something like the NHS or defense budgets. Whenever these arguments come up at your state levels, it seems to me this is likely to be a claim we need to address, or at least an argument we need to address. Advocating for the public value of the humanities constrains the nature of the debate in certain ways. It doesn't prohibit discussion of how, for example, they bring deep fulfillment personally and often give meaning and shape to our lives. I'm actually quoting the Minister of Higher Education there. But it does require such statements to be supported by some sense of how these potential benefits to the individual contribute to public life. As pressingly thinking about the public value of higher scholarship in the humanities requires one to be able to distinguish different aspects to the idea of a public good. The kinds of good represented by the study of the humanities are not all expressible as economic goods. At least one political theorist has argued that they're much better expressed as human goods, counting among the things that contribute either directly or indirectly to human being, and that are, of course, richly diverse and heterogeneous in character. They rarely, if ever, have the status of necessities. That is, it's hard to imagine circumstances under which they will meet the standard of basic requirement or vital interest entailed in the word need. Few things do. We have an absolute need of something when we can accurately say that to be deprived of it will be to experience harm or some serious impairment to our capacity to flourish. Air, food, peace, a roof over our heads, basic healthcare, education in our formative years. On the other hand, it's a sign of being a prosperous, stable, educationally and culturally rich society that we can come to experience as needs, things whose absence or diminishment would be, strictly speaking, a relative rather than an absolute impoverishment. What would be meant under such circumstances by claiming that public support for humanities scholarship is necessary is that it is strongly desired, and that lessening that support would be an acutely felt impoverishment. Some people will want to say at this point that the language of need rightly expands its range in keeping with advancements in the wealth and complexity of the society concerned, that it comes to encompass the wish for prosperity. Given that absolute needs still exist even in highly advanced societies, it seems to me better to retain the clarity of the language and to talk rather of our desires and interests and cultural attachments as having a different priority from our needs and requiring a different order of justification. In short, let's keep the rudimentary distinction between needs or vital interests and desires or interests or cultural attachments which may be strong but not absolutely vital. Recognizing that these distinctions apply is only the first stage in comparative deliberation about public goods. The hard part of the problem is finding justifications for those non-necessary desirables that will enable meaningful comparison with other non-necessary desirables in a situation of practical deliberation. Necessities take themselves out of the debate by virtue of being necessities. They're the priorities that have to be met, though there will be debate about how to meet them most efficiently and which are the legitimate priorities and which ones are marginal or spurious. What one's left with after that initial step are problems of judgment, of arbitration between the claims of what will often be seen as incommensurable goods. These judgments of value are not themselves economic in kind, though they may well be the means of deciding the allocation of finite economic resources. They will require debate about the relative importance in a given context of different values and commitments, many of which will not obviously be rankable in the same scale. There's an odd thing that happens in humanities debates in Britain all the time, and I think the only thing one can do is make it explicit, which is that advocates for the humanities tend to think about economics as holding prior or better or simply more important information that knocks any arguments we want to make out of the room. You can bring all the economic data to the room you like. In the end, what economists, just like the rest of us, have to do is sit down and make judgments. It does seem to me that the economists have started to fill the place that was once filled by science in these debates. There is a particular form of indignation familiar within discussions of the value of the humanities, which produces or accompanies an outright refusal to engage with comparisons between incommensurables. The gist of the indignation is that the good of the humanities, for example, cannot be weighed in the balance against most other kinds of public good, because the goods entailed are not only incommensurable, lacking a common measure, but incomparable, unable to be compared with respect to some specific consideration, beauty, for example. So within the framework of university budgeting, the indignant response would say that we cannot measure the value of the humanities against the value of the sciences or social sciences because the kinds of work they do are fundamentally unlike. Or within the more complex frameworks required to decide government budgets, we cannot weigh the claims of university research in the humanities against investments in new forms of energy or new hospitals or additional resources for the armed forces, because educating the nation, improving its health, increasing its capacity to defend itself and its allies are fundamentally non-comparable aims. Whether and in what way some values are indeed incommensurable and for some also incomparable is the subject of a now large literature. Given that my concerns with justifications or reasons for claiming public value, I'm going to restrict my comments here to a couple of key points from the philosophical debate, since I take the economic debate to follow from it and be a secondary interpretation of what are fundamentally philosophical issues. Incomparability, some philosophers have argued, can be a constitutive, almost a definitive feature of certain goods. For example, there are some situations, Joseph Raz observes, in which judgment that two things are incomparable. Have I got Joseph Raz? Right on. I'm just going to leave that there because I think I'm probably on the wrong slide. Never mind. Incomparability, some philosophers have argued, can be a constitutive, almost a definitive feature of certain goods. For example, there are some situations, Joseph Raz observes, in which the judgment that two things are incommensurable has symbolic significance for us, partly determined by social conventions. So the idea that one would not trade friendship or the love of one's child or one's spouse for any amount of money finds from most of us emphatic approval, and invitations to do otherwise meet with strong resistance or even revulsion. Some such judgments may well prove upon close inspection not to be absolute. There will be circumstances in which one may act directly or more often indirectly in such a way as to give acquisition of money apparent priority over the claims of friendship or family. You take a job in an inconvenient place, for example. But Joseph Raz concludes that certain judgments about the non-comparability of certain opinions and certain attitudes to the exchangeability of options are constitutive of relations with friends, spouses, parents, etc. Only those who hold the view that friendship is neither better nor worse than money, but is simply not comparable to money or other commodities, are capable of having friends. So with regard to the problem under discussion, we might take the view that only those who hold that higher scholarship in the humanities is neither better nor worse than the pursuit of economic or commercial gain, is simply not comparable to such ends-driven activity, are capable of producing humane scholarship. If you don't get it, you're inhumane. Really worries me how often advocates for the humanities basically claim that we are more human or more humane than others. Such objections to comparisons between some abstract values are, I suspect, likely to appeal to many scholars of the humanities. They're certainly implicit in a lot of casual talk about our claim to public value. But in practice, of course, comparisons between incomparable goods are made all the time. We all know that many people regularly reach successful decisions in such difficult circumstances for deliberation, and I'm quoting Elijah Milgram here, are subsequently prepared to pronounce on the relative importance of the considerations that entered into their decision. How they do it depends largely on what framing ideas and values they hold about what will best advance the overall happiness of a life. Many of those values are bequeathed to us, but they're not unchallengeable dicta. We may tell our children to do and value certain things that belong to our own picture of the well-lived life, Milgram points out, but we also expect them to form their own judgments and quite possibly to change those judgments over the course of their lives, not least because their cultural experience and the context in which their society deliberates about public goods will be different from ours. The appeal to a framing idea about what makes for a fulfilling life seems likely to invite dispute in the case of the value of the humanities. In other words, we can't finally constrain the people who don't get it, who think, for example, that it is all about maximizing financial improvements. There is indeed good cause to observe that the implied analogy between how governments or societies reach decisions about allocating finite public resources and how individuals prioritize different values and commitments that have importance for them is helpful only up to a point. Beyond that point, we need rather to be able to draw on impersonal justifications that describe what goods we collectively think a complex society and culture should continue to report to support. On the other hand, that was Joseph Raz, just when you needed it. Ooh, death of the screen. Never mind, you can just listen to this one. On the other hand, as Bernard Williams observed at an early stage in the debate about pluralism and incommensurability, we will find ourselves in trouble as a society if the ways in which we express and encourage important values drift too far from our private sentiments and intuitions about values. This is Bernard Williams. Private understanding can live with a good deal of intuition and unresolved conflict. Public order, unless we are to give up the ethical ambition that it be answerable, can only live with less. At the same time, the public order, if it is to carry conviction and also not to flatten human experience, has to find ways in which it can be adequately related to private sentiment, which remains more intuitive and open to conflict than public rules can be. Not the least contribution the humanities can make to the public good is that they offer long considered and finally developed ways of thinking about what the nature of that relation should be. Now, to go further here and fabricate a hypothetical scenario in which the humanities' claim to public money is tested against claims from the NHS, the army, and so forth would be spurious. The dinner table conversation keeps running up against this point where I'm being told I have to write that article for the popular press and I'm resisting. In practice, as everybody knows, distributions at this level of comparison are decided largely on the basis of past allocations. So in practice, something only goes wrong if the public debate suddenly decides that those past allocations have been wrong, in which case you can also appeal to a long history of cultural belief that the things we are currently supporting do have value. The more relevant comparisons are between claims nearer in kind, say doctoral research versus public subsidy for the arts, that's a harder one for us, or funding for certain humanities projects versus others in the social sciences or sciences. These are finally matters for debate and judgment around a table with detailed and current contextual data to hand. In practice and in principle, what matters if the debate and the judgment are to command respect, is that those who are participating have a sufficiently plural and internally refined or refinable understanding of what the modes of justification and valuation that support each rival claimant for funding are. If the taxonomy I've worked out and the refinements supplied in support of each claim can make it easier to see what those supports for the humanities are, it will have done enough. Thank you very much. Thank you.